Issue 90. After Sonic finds Mina in the woods and naturally lampshades how dangerous a risk she's taking being here, Sonic pushes Mina out of the way of an explosion that I'm not sure how he knew would happen to avoid getting hit by it, and some giant robots deactivate their cloaking devices. Why would they ever do that? They had a huge advantage over them! Why would they ever give up that willingly? I wonder if Uncle Chuck is faking not having free will. And Eggman seems to wonder that too. After a brief happy moment where Sally's mom says she's strong enough to walk right away, we immediately find out that the same cannot be said for the king, who can't move his legs. Well, that sucks, but compared to being dead, that's not a problem, is it? And besides, a king doesn't exactly need legs to begin with. Always sitting on a throne or something. If anything, this will keep him from foolishly getting into fights again. This injury probably saved his life in the long run. Meanwhile, Mina gets grabbed being helpless, because of course she was, and what's worse, the Sword of Acorns gets magnetically attracted to a combat, a different one from the one holding Mina. Sonic then has a dilemma, as he thinks that while the sword can restore Chuck to normal, Mina basically wants to be carried off and roboticized. I'd say save the sword, because it'd help way more people than one stupid girl, but Sonic doesn't think with logic. So he's gonna risk the sword to save her, isn't he? Sonic saves Mina and then gets knocked out by robots using the cloaking device again, only for them to go back to deactivating it. Is the cloaking device using up so much power that they can only keep it activated for a little bit? While Mina is carrying an unconscious Sonic, she notices in her adrenaline rush that her feet are kicking up dirt like crazy, and decides to worry about that later and runs at unusually fast speed, thinking with Sonic's slang. So either she actually is useful after all, or somehow holding Sonic gives her superpower. Either way, this feels like a Deus Ex Machina at the moment. Well, I know it's pronounced Deus Ex Machina, but that sounds really weird to me. I'd rather pronounce it the way I always do. Jeffrey sees the king telling Elias that his mother needs time to adjust to him being paralyzed from the waist down, so as of this moment, Elias is going to be the acting head of state. I guess he does feel like he deserves a little break, but he can still rule just fine. I don't like how the king's first text box seems to be connected to the wrong person. Queen Alicia, who looks way too much like Sally in this panel, is a good mom by reassuring Sally that this setback is probably only temporary. And Jeffrey has to cut the king off from whatever he was going to say by telling him that the Sword of Acorns has been stolen. And yeah, temporary. It is temporary, because we see the king walking around just fine in the good future in the In Your Face special. After Eggman brags about it, he's informed that two unidentified objects are in free fall over Mobius and are headed towards Robotatropolis, and he tells the Combots to forget Sonic and return to base at once. Skewed priorities there? After Sonic reassures the sad Mina about losing the sword because she saved their lives, Eggman somehow knows that the falling objects are meteors and plans to watch from a rooftop observation deck. Sonic tells Mina to stay put, and after fighting a robot, it seems to get sliced in half. And Eggman brags that this would be an energy shield, and now the sword belongs to him. Wait, an energy shield? Slice something in half? Eggman says, "Who says the energy field was meant to get Sonic out?" And Sonic looks up at some falling meteors, so I'm guessing he's being trapped in place to make them all hit him. Then the next story, members of the Albion Brotherhood see the aftermath of Knuckles' fight, and it ends with one of the female echidnas being shocked at what happened to Knuckles. Meanwhile, Antoine and his friends can't find an elevator, and after Bunny ditzily suggests the stairs to someone with crutches, and I hope she means she'll carry him down them, Robin shoots an arrow that results in them all having a hanger to slide down together. Robin gets the idea to dress up like firemen, which I guess is supposed to be a disguise, forgetting the fact that they still aren't echidnas and will still stick out like a sore thumb. But then they seem to head towards the smoke, so maybe there's a practical purpose for them having a hose with them, being dressed like firemen and stuff. Oh, huh, this is when it starts to happen. I heard about this. Knuckles looks like a glowing green ghost of chaos energy, not a good look for him. And one of the Kinda women says that he looks like the video file Steppenwolf left her with regard to his uncle Dimitri after he subjected himself to the chaos siphon. I didn't think Steppenwolf even knew about Albion, let alone with 10 video files there. I guess he stumbled upon it in his guardian job. Knuckles says that he feels like he's burning up. No explanation is given as to why he's like this so far. And after the brainwashed father of Antoine slaps Antoine, Knuckles imprisons him in a force field, standing up to him that that's not how a father should treat his son. Antoine idealistically insists on reasoning with his father, even though he should know he has no free will, and he explains that on his way over, he made a refueling stop in the North Tundra, where he met up with Rotor, who gave them an electronic neutralizer. This convenient invention that Rotor really should have invented a long time ago will allow a person to place a roboticized Homobia in stasis, allowing people to transport him safely. After the echidna woman annoyingly refuses to go along with the plan and tells him to let the security team murder his father, Knuckles tells them all to stop and teleports Amy and Robin to a forest, and we cut back to Antoine and Bunny with their goal solidly achieved, with no sign of Knuckles anywhere. And the Albion woman is also stupidly suspicious of Knuckles being powerful, even though he's a guardian. Genre blindness once again. The first story was written by Carl Bowlers, and as Sonic loses a sword of acorns to a combat, who proceed to take advantage of the sword to trap Sonic in a force field while some meteors are headed for Robotropolis. Also, Mina's there, and saves Sonic's life by inexplicably running at the speed of sound, so I gotta give credit to her for being useful. If she keeps running like this, I might change my mind about her being useless. So yeah, Sonic loses his sword, which is really annoying to me, and the King finds out he's paralyzed from the waist down, which logically will only help him by keeping him from rushing into battle again. But he and his loving, motherly wife are still so unhappy about it that they make Elias the acting head of state. Not good for someone who doesn't really want to be. And the next story by Ken Penders has Knuckles instinctively tap into his guardian powers to save the day from annoying, genre-blind idiots by making sure Antoine gets his father back. Problem is, he's now a green, glowing embodiment of chaos energy, and I've heard bad things about this. This is a story arc that I can attest to dragging out far too long. My only problem so far is that he doesn't look good that way, and that does not really make clear how this happened. He's gotten into plenty of fights before and not gone super or whatever like this.